Ever wonder what Grimm's fairy tales are really about? Stick around to meet the lady who's breathing new life into these old tales.
I often think of the life I've led, and oh, it's a wonder I ain't dead. Drinking and gambling, staying out all night, living in a fool's paradise.
Welcome. My guest this evening is Natalie Frank, a talented visual artist who recently produced an incredible new version of Grimm's fairy tales. It's 75 of her drawings, along with 36 tales, and the tales are completely unsanitized. Welcome, Natalie.
Thank you so much for having
me. It's wonderful to have you.
It's an honor to be here.
So, Tales of the Brothers Grimm.
Yes.
Why?
Well, it's important to say I looked at the unsanitized versions, so the 1812 to 1857. Very nasty, very violent and sexy stories that a lot of people don't know. I was in an artist friend's studio probably 5 years ago, Paula Rego, who's a Portuguese artist who lives in London. And she's made her career working with fairy tales. And she said to me, we were talking about what we were reading, and she said, you should really look at these stories. They're unusual because of the strong roles that women play in them, and there's so much naughtiness and nastiness that goes on. I think you'd really like them. And so I went.
You being someone who likes naughtiness and nastiness.
Exactly, exactly, in literature, of course. And so I just went on Amazon and ordered the first book I saw, which happened to be Jack Sipes' collected tales. And he had it was over 211 tales, so it was household tales, children's tales, fairy tales, folk tales, wonder tales. And I started to read through it and was just kind of captivated by it as literature and as a book. And so it started very casually, kind of reading for fun, and then it got much more serious. Once Claire Gilman, who's the curator at the Drawing Center, came over and we were talking about putting it together a show, which is where this work is now on view at the Drawing Center in Soho. And once we started talking about a show, I thought, I really want to do a book, that these stories create such interesting worlds and they're so encapsulating. And especially, you know, when you go through a book of 211 of them, this very poignant world emerges. And so I wanted my book to mirror that idea of creating another world where these fairy tales live. And so I thought, you know, if I'm gonna draw them, as a visual artist, I'd never done anything like this. I'd primarily done, you know, been a painter and worked with oil and I'd never done a series of drawings.
And themes you'd been informed by in your previous work?
Same as these. I had never worked concretely from literature before. I had been inspired by The Master and Margarita or Saramago or Borges, but never done something so directly as these Grimm's drawings, which don't really illustrate the stories, but they do take key scenes and sort of jump off from there. And so my drawings are very much feminist interpretations of the stories because I was so compelled by these strong women, evil and divine, in the stories.
And so what makes a feminist interpretation of these stories? What constitutes that?
Well, I guess, you know, I learned through reading about these Grimms that they started out as oral tales. And as oral tales, they were really considered actually proto-feminist because they were women's art. And so women told them in the home, in the kitchen, by the well. And women,
these are women's stories.
Women's stories. And they were creating roles for themselves that weren't allowed in society because of the church and the state. And they were kind of projecting their fantasies and transgressions and desires onto these stories. So a lot of them do fit into patriarchal terms because that's how society was structured. But in the 19th century, these structures were changing. The idea of the bourgeois was changing. The idea of relationships and gender relationships was changing. So there was this slippage and this like potential for expression, mm-hmm. which I think the stories really inhabit.
Sure.
And you can see that. And so there are stories in the Grimms, unlike any fairy tales you've read. Like there's a story about the clever farmer's daughter, a woman who solves a riddle and outsmarts the king mm-hmm. time and time again. Mm-hmm. And in the end, he banishes her because she makes a fool of him. And he says to her, you can take one thing that's most important to you from the kingdom. And she drugs him and he wakes up and she's taken him. And so he's so impressed by this, they get married again.
And live happily ever after.
And live happily ever after.
And this is one of the stories that you depict.
Yes, it is.
And that's on exhibit right now
yes.
at the Drawing Center.
And it's actually one that's in the show. Mm-hmm. So the Drawing Center has shown 25 of the large 75 color drawings
yep.
that are in the show.
So that was so striking to me, just the vibrancy of the color,
mm-hmm.
right? And these are all pastel.
Gouache and chalk pastel,
uh-huh.
layered.
Uh-huh.
It's really interesting because the gouache in some ways can mimic paint. I mean, it is a acrylic,
uh-huh.
But it can be transparent, it can be opaque, but it really sinks into the surface. I used a really thick watercolor paper,
uh-huh.
and the chalk really stays on the surface, and I use a very thick paper
uh-huh.
And textured paper.
Sure.
So there's a really nice interplay between surface and depth.
Yep.
It's sort of inherent in the media itself.
And the gouache also kind of gives you, there's an element of sort of almost like a wetness to the gouache
yeah.
versus this sort of...
Yeah.
The chalkiness of mm-hmm. the chalk pastels.
Yeah.
And so 25 pieces that are exhibited. Yeah, the sort of words that were coming to mind for me were mm-hmm. just, I was thinking about how colorful mm-hmm. these are. These
yep.
are incredibly vibrant
right.
pieces. There's an element to the grotesque.
Yes.
And a sort of surreality to them as
mm-hmm.
well, right? I mean,
yep.
images that involve women's heads with things coming out of them.
Mm-hmm.
And so, did you go through these stories and take us through your process for translating, you know, a few pages of a fairy tale,
sure.
albeit ones that have been deeply kind of made for Disney to the extent that
right.
Americans have absorbed many of these, right? But sort of going through the stories and actually turning that into these beautiful drawings.
Oh, thank you. Well, the stories themselves were so compelling
mm-hmm.
that visual images came to mind immediately.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have depth perception, and for that, the doctor who put me in front of the machines and had me look at a grayscale says I have an overdeveloped sense of color that helps me to distinguish depth.
Oh, interesting. And
this
is something that was diagnosed as
midway through this project.
Oh, no way.
So it really, I think you see in the span of this work, because it covered 4.5 years,
uh-huh.
you see the work change. And I was also, your point about seriality, I was very aware that I was making drawings that I wanted to read in sequence in a book. And so I went through and picked what stories sort of spoke to me and I thought were really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And by that I mean I wanted to include very well-known Grimm stories
mm-hmm.
that everyone has heard of, like Cinderella and Sleeping Beauty, which is actually called Briar Rose
mm-hmm.
in this in the Grimms, Little Red Riding Hood, which is Little Red Cap. And use some of those well-known stories with the unknown details that were later sanitized in 1823
mm-hmm.
By the brothers themselves when they wanted to increase sales of their editions.
Oh, interesting. So these guys became the definitive sort of interpreters of these stories that have been passed down for generations, principally through women.
Yes.
And then for commercial reasons,
sanitized
and to kind of get them to a wider audience.
And actually illustrated them. And so in their original forms, they were not illustrated.
Huh.
So it was the third brother, Ludwig, who actually illustrated them. But I was aware of picking stories that were beloved, I think, because in the English versions, our first versions were the sanitized ones
mm-hmm.
because a British translator brought those into English.
Mm-hmm.
And Jack Zipes, whose translations I used, who wrote the introduction to my book, actually was the first to translate the unsanitized into English in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to show some of those details, like in Cinderella in the wedding scene, the stepsisters have their eyes pecked out by birds and they self-amputate to try to fit in the slipper.
Hmm.
So I wanted to show some of those details, but
mm-hmm.
also choose stories that were not well known
mm-hmm.
like The Ungrateful Son or The Clever Farmer's Daughter, and put those sort of groupings together. Mm-hmm. And then in terms of the images themselves, some I wanted to be portraits mm-hmm. and to come forward, and some I wanted the reader to kind of step inside and have it be landscapes or interiors with multi-figures.
Sure, sure. And in walking the exhibit, you had several pieces for a single story. Mm-hmm. Did you have a kind of, you know, approach methodology mm-hmm. that you took around that? How did you determine how many pieces you were going to do for each and such?
I went through and read the stories, and some stories I knew I had to do, mm-hmm. like Sleeping Beauty or Cinderella, Rapunzel. Mm-hmm. And so I picked which stories I wanted to do, and then I kind of read through the stories and thought, how many drawings do I need per this per mm-hmm. story mm-hmm. to represent sort of the key scenes that define this story?
Sure.
While also making sure that I represent those scenes that were not well known.
Uh-huh.
Of beloved stories.
So there is definitely a kind of impulse to unearth and
yes.
get back to...
And play around with, there's such great roles in mm-hmm. the stories mm-hmm. and they're such quirky characters. And for instance, in the original Little Red Riding Hood, the way that the Brothers Grimm, so the women actually, the way the stories began, the women would come to the Brothers Grimm's home and tell them the stories in their home, sort of bourgeois women. And in the beginning of the publishing of the first large edition, 1812 and 1815, the brothers lied about the origin. And they said they went out and gathered them from peasant women as this kind of tool of German nationalism. Mm-hmm. But that was not true.
Hmm.
They were interested in the language of the stories.
Mm-hmm.
So they took these stories, oral stories from women, and then they sort of changed them around and added poetics and language to make them more fun and enjoyable mm-hmm. and to read sort of more poetically.
And so these stories were not kind of well known culturally at the time this project?
They were, but uh-huh. because they were oral tales, they weren't recorded.
Uh-huh.
They were oral.
Yep.
And so many of them, because they were oral tales, were derivations of other stories.
Mm-hmm.
So for instance, All Fur, which is one of the two incest stories,
mm-hmm.
has the Cinderella story tale type within it.
Mm-hmm.
So there are all these tale types and they're sort of mixed and matched in different stories.
Got it. And All Fur is another one that's on exhibit
at the
Drawing Center. Yeah.
Yeah.
So they gather these women in to document the stories. They mm-hmm. rearrange some elements of the story,
mm-hmm.
make them more poetic.
Mm-hmm.
And the Brothers Grimm were authors. What was their business before?
They were philologists.
Okay.
So they were making German dictionaries and encyclopedias, and they
mm-hmm.
were actually royal librarians
hmm.
in Kassel.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them was trained as a lawyer.
Hmm.
But their achievement, I think, historically, have been the German dictionary, encyclopedia, and then the Grimm's Fairy Tales,
mm-hmm.
which is still the second highest selling book in Germany after the Bible.
Wow.
And they you know, protected this legacy and told and retold and republished these stories for close to 50 years.
Sure. And so what's been the reaction that you've gotten to your work and to this incredible book that you assembled here?
Yeah. Well, it's been a great thrill to show the work and show this body of work, and because I'm a painter by background,
mm-hmm.
And drawing for me had always been more about observation.
Mm-hmm. So a step in your painting process?
Life drawing, and
mm-hmm.
not even a step because I don't sketch, but it, for me it had always been, I started life drawing when I was 12,
mm-hmm.
and continued that practice through graduate school.
What is life drawing?
Looking at the nude model
mm-hmm.
and drawing
mm-hmm.
and learning about anatomy and light and color and muscle tone
mm-hmm.
and the human body.
These are all things that are very much at play in these pieces.
Yeah, because I think when you asked about these as interpretations, they are feminist. Certainly they're feminist interpretations. I was captivated by the roles for women that women created
mm-hmm.
in the stories.
Mm-hmm.
But the stories themselves are, they're so full of complexity and kind of conundrums, in that sometimes they are patriarchal and sometimes
mm-hmm.
they are feminist, but basically they are humanist tales.
Mm-hmm.
And I started drawing when I was so young because for me it was always about the body.
Mm.
And it was about using the body to tell stories.
Mm-hmm.
And so the artists I started looking at, a lot of Weimar artists, like Hette Kollwitz and Max Beckmann and Oskar Kokoschka and Nolde, and they were artists talking about their time through the body. So it seemed apt that if I'm going to take historical text, which is very much alive, but in a different, in a, like you said, Disneyfied form, that I wanted to make it my own and make it feel contemporary. And for me, that was the way I put this book together and the way that I interpreted, especially the roles of women in these stories. Because I thought they were so funny. I mean, even The Witch and Hansel and Gretel had no, well, Hansel and Gretel had no appeal to me as characters. They felt very simplistic and
a little flat.
Dolty. I love The Witch.
Or in what about The Witch was compelling?
Well, she was just so evil and funny and, you know, sticking Hansel in a little pen and fattening him up, but she couldn't quite see. So then they knew how to trick her and hold out, you know, a chicken bone so she wouldn't quite think that was his finger and that he was fat enough to kill yet. And that interplay of violence and humor between her and these little children, which is what life was like then when you had so many mothers dying in childbirth and you had these kids thrown into these families with people they didn't like and there was no money and they had to all feed each other and live together. And so you see a lot of stories, which I find really humorous, like The Juniper Tree, which is about a stepmother killing her stepson, decapitating him, and then putting his head back on his body and telling her daughter to go poke him so the head rolls off, and then cooking him and feeding him to the father.
And what do you make of all this?
I think it's hilarious. I mean, it's, you know, Jack writes about these stories as, I mean, he is the Marxist Grimm scholar, but he writes about these stories as a reflection of their time. And they did represent real anxieties of women, but also of society that whose structure was changing, of, you know, an upwardly mobile working class. So you have a lot of...
A proletariat.
You have a lot of stories about, like, ingenuous... tailors and soldiers and people who, you know, if they're industrious, they can like have a happy ending. So I think they're in, they're really fascinating because they, of what they represent for their time.
And so were you as a child growing up, as you began drawing and taking inspiration from the human body, were there particular stories that really resonated with you? Kind of what were your sources of inspiration, you know, growing up? What kind of caused you to gravitate towards drawing the human form?
I think, I mean, I just looked in the mirror and saw myself, and I think seeing Hette Kollwitz's work for the first time was really the first artist I really fell in love with.
And how old were you when
I think I was 12.
How did you get exposed to?
Well, my mom, I think, gave me a book of her diaries, which had drawings in them. And she was a fascinating woman. And she was married to a doctor. She drew a lot of his patients. And she lost one son in World War I, one in World War II. She was bisexual. She was celebrated in her lifetime. She was an amazing draftsman, but used her drawing to represent the workers a lot. And so there are a lot of protests and uprising and kind of socialist pictures. But she also did these very tender and intimate pictures of domestic life and so many self-portraits. And I did so that was sort of my entry way into art. And I did a lot of self-portraits. I drew myself a lot when I was young.
The original selfie.
Except mine were very angsty.
Got it.
Like Francis Bacon.
I can't imagine anything angsty coming out of you.
Well, these are not angsty. These are joyous.
Tell me a little bit about these angsty pieces of art that you created as a young person.
Well, Francis Bacon, there were some crucifixions. I remember my college interview, the interviewer saying, "Why do you choose to pick Jesus?" As a young woman. But I think living in, you know, I grew up in Dallas, and I went to a non-denominational co-ed school, but I had a lot
non-denominational, but Christian or non-denominational?
Non-denominational co-ed, but rambunctious school.
Got it.
Very Southern.
Uh-huh.
And there were a lot of issues with me. I would go to my nude figure drawing classes. My mother had to go with me.
This was a class you took at school or a class
this
you took in the
class
community?
This is a class I took in a woman's, in like a hippie woman's garage with like 8 6-year-old women.
Got it.
My mother went with me because I was so young and there was nudity. And we would draw after school twice a week for 3 or 4 hours till 10 at night.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would bring the drawings back to my high school. And the director of the art program tried to kick me out of school for being a pornographer.
So you were making waves.
They kept me out of the honor society. They
no
said
way.
I was had no honor. So I read a lot.
Uh-huh.
And I was always drawn to stories and magic realism.
Uh-huh.
And I looked at a lot of art and worked and kept to myself a lot.
I
tried
see.
Not to get kicked
that
out
was,
of school.
That was life for you growing up in Dallas.
Yeah, pretty much.
And were you kind of itching to get out of Dallas?
Very much.
Uh-huh.
I knew I wanted to go to school up east, and I had never, you know, I came.
Did you just say up east?
Yeah, up east.
Up east,
right?
Why not?
Isn't that where we are?
That's exactly where we are.
Well, to me, that was, you know, I went to New York once a year growing up, and this was this magical place with
this
museums and
with,
subways and opera, and you know, I'd never been to an opera before I went to college, and I luckily had an amazing master at my residential college.
Mm-hmm. So you went to Yale?
I went to Yale.
And so you'd come down here periodically on the Metro North?
He would take a group of us,
uh-huh.
but I was his favorite student, down for the weekends, and we would see opera. I had never, you know, eaten like a lobster before.
Mm-hmm.
We would go see museums. We'd meet his artist friends. We'd run around the city. It was...
Sounds incredible.
It was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And he's an engineer.
Mm-hmm.
And he just felt it was important to expose young people to things they were interested
mm-hmm.
in.
And so what did you study in college?
Art.
Art.
But I had a psychotic professor who thought he saw promise in me and so decided to torture me and thought we were in the army.
So you were like living Whiplash before the movie
yes.
came out.
Yes, no, that's exactly right.
Uh-huh.
And he had me doing like 100 drawings a week to the point I made a C in English and flipped out and dropped all my art classes. And he got so angry he kept me out of certain programs. So I took as few art classes as possible at Yale, actually.
Okay.
It
but
was
continued to
continued,
do art.
So the master of my college gave me a studio,
uh-huh.
and every summer would give me money and say, go wherever you want in the world, go study at the École des Beaux-Arts, go study at the Slade, go study at the Florence Academy, learn, travel, see art, go to parts of the world you've never been,
mm-hmm.
come back, put on a show, just go have fun. And
that's
just saw
else.
To it that whatever I needed,
you had,
it was there.
The
and supported
evolution
me.
Evolution and growth was happening.
And he's still one of my, I mean, I owe him so much, and he's one of my closest friends, and
that's
he's an
fantastic.
Amazing man. Yeah.
He saw this exciting person with
well,
exciting things to
I
deliver
excited.
To the world.
I was excited. I was just excited. I mean, I still am about
mm-hmm.
art and what it can do, and, you know, I think exploring the idea of putting these drawings, not only putting them in a book, but making a book with, you know, hand drawing all the title pages and the borders and the end papers and the cover,
mm-hmm.
and then going out and finding people I really admire, women,
mm-hmm.
who would contribute to the book, and meeting Jack Sipes and using his translations, and he was sort of my guide into the fairy tale world.
Sure.
It was so fun to think about using my work in another way.
Mm-hmm. So you're a kind of a different form of distribution,
yeah.
I suppose, right?
And it yep. really made me sort of so hungry to do more. I'd like to do stage sets for ballets, and I'd love to do, I want to do more books. I'm going to do more books.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And what did you do between graduating college and doing an MFA a bit later?
So I had a great first year. I left, I graduated from Yale, and I was like, what do you do as an artist?
Well, this is what I hope you'll shed some light on.
How do you begin life as an artist?
Uh-huh.
What does that mean?
Right, you weren't like dropping your resume off at the Office of Career Services to go interview for 16 jobs on Wall Street.
No, unfortunately.
Uh-huh.
And so a friend who had graduated was working at the Met, and
mm-hmm.
so she gave them my resume.
Mm-hmm.
And the curator of modern and contemporary art, Dr. Nan Rosenthal, was the curator at the time,
mm-hmm.
and she was hiring. And so every year she had a new assistant,
mm-hmm.
And it was an internship. So my parents were really, they were like, you have 1 year, we will help you figure it out. Mm-hmm. If you want to do this, do this. So mm-hmm. I went to her house and she was the...
But now they were obviously very supportive of you.
Very supportive. And that
and
I cannot...
recognize your amazing without, talent with, as well.
But without that support, I think so many people don't have that support. And mm-hmm. I feel really lucky to mm-hmm. have had it because it makes all the difference. Mm-hmm. And they weren't, I mean, yes, there was a time because they're all in medicine. They really hoped I would combine my love of arts with plastic surgery, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. they accepted it. And so I went to interview with Nan, and she was the foremost Jasper Johnson Robert Rauschenberg scholar. Hmm. And so I showed up at her, you know, Fifth Avenue, whatever, apartment, and she answered the door in a house coat, hair curlers, with a scotch and a cigarette, and it was like 11 a.m. She was like, come in. So she sat me down in her living room with mm-hmm. Fontanas and Chuck Close's and John's, and I mean, this collection of modern art like mm-hmm. you've never seen, mm-hmm. with books everywhere. And I sat about 30 feet away from her, and she interviewed me for about an hour. And I think because I didn't
start... Was it a good interview?
Well, I didn't start crying, uh-huh. so I think I got the job. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. And I worked for her for a year. Uh-huh. And I did things like write wall copy, catalog text. I'd, you know, empty her ashtrays. Mm-hmm. I got to, you know, listen to her tell stories about de Kooning every day mm-hmm. at lunch while she drank Dewars and smoked cigarettes. But learned a tremendous amount and met a lot of really exceptional people in the art world. Mm-hmm. From the museum side... And it was during that year that I met Linda Nochlin, who ended up becoming a very close friend and mentor, and who's written an essay in this book, the mm-hmm. Great Feminist Art Historian.
Let's talk about some of the exciting magic that you and Linda have made in terms of dealing with some of these social and political issues that are in these stories that mm-hmm. we may not mm-hmm. fully know. What are some of the kind of key themes that emerge here?
Well, for the book, I wanted three women to write the essays. So mm-hmm. Jack Sipes wrote the introduction. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I used his translations of the stories. Mm-hmm. And it was important for me to have Linda as a feminist voice scholar mm-hmm. In the book. But what surprised me was that she feels that the tales reinforce patriarchy. Mm-hmm. And it's very divided. It is somewhat divided in the fairy tale world. Marina Warner writes about the tales from the viewpoint of a feminist mm-hmm. And as feminist tales. Jack Sipes thinks, you know, more as a Marxist and thinks the feminism is but one aspect, mm-hmm. but sort of downplays it a bit. Mm-hmm. So I was surprised that Linda, as this great feminist, did not see that in the stories, but mm-hmm. she didn't, and I think a lot of people don't. Mm-hmm. But for her essay, she focused on My Little Red Riding Hood, mm-hmm. and she had always wanted to write a essay about the use of the fairy tale in art. Hmm. So she discusses different artists who have used the fairy tale, Kiki Smith being one, Paula Rego, who the book is dedicated to, who mm-hmm. gave me the inspiration,
sure.
being another, and just wrote a beautiful essay about the drawings themselves and the history of the use of the fairy tale. Mm-hmm. And it was really funny, we were expecting her essay and we were waiting for her essay, and one day I get an email and it's from Linda, and she sent me an erotic poem that my drawings inspired in her.
She composed it.
From Little Red Riding Hood. Uh-huh. It was in some kind of beautiful verse, which I don't know. And it was wonderful, very erotic and nasty. Mm-hmm. But we didn't end up using it in the book. It didn't fit the tone.
Understood.
Well,
but you've kept it as an important keepsake.
Absolutely. Good. And so Linda contributed that essay, and that's the first one mm-hmm. in the book. And we separate the book between the 36 tales, Jack Sipes' translations, and then my 75 drawings, which punctuate them, mm-hmm. all with title pages and borders that are illustrated. And then in the back, we have the Linda Nochlin essay, a conversation between myself and Julie Taymor mm-hmm. about who I thought would be really fascinating to talk to about the use of the fairy tale. Her degrees and background are in fairy tales and folklore and mythology. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And because she sort of gets at these things, narratives and women and magic realism and fairy tales in three dimensions, and I'm doing it in two, mm-hmm. I thought that could be an interesting dialogue.
Sure. And how'd that conversation go?
It was wonderful. I had done a lot of research about her, and she reaches from so many traditions and tales, and so many.
She's probably best known for, like, to the popular audiences, like the creative The Lion King.
Lion King, Titus, Midsummer Night's Dream. She's done a lot of work with Shakespeare, The Green Bird. Her use with her use of masks and. It was really interesting. She draws, she has never worked directly from a Grimm's fairy tale, which was, funnily enough, the first question we asked her, I asked her, was, have you been influenced by the Grimms? And she said no. But she has been influenced by all of the people who influenced the Grimms, such as Ovid and Shakespeare and Indonesian myths. And so it was actually a really interesting, more kind of exploratory conversation.
Sure. Very cool. Well, I would encourage everybody to get out and see this exhibit.
Thank you.
It's going to be up until June 28th.
Yes.
Drawing Center.
Yes.
35 Worcester.
Yes.
New York City, New York.
Soho, yep.
Yep. And then traveling down to
my hometown. Yep.
Austin, Texas.
Yes, the Blanton.
And it's going to be the Blanton, part of the University of Texas.
At Austin's museum. And they actually have an amazing archive, the Ransom, at the Ransom Center. And so the exhibition will be expanded from 25 to about 35 drawings, and we'll have one room devoted to the book. So we'll have my book in the room, and then we're pulling old Grimm's editions from 1812 on.
Oh, wow.
To put in the room. And there have been so few fine artists who have looked at the Grimms, and this is actually the largest collection ever illustrated by
artists,
which is really fun. But we're going to use David Hockney. He did some wonderful etchings after the Grimms, so we'll use some of his and show kind of Grimms through the years, but weighted on the 19th century versions.
Understood. And so whom have you found that this book really resonates with? I mean, how are people coming to it? How are they engaging with it?
Oh, well, it's not for children, or it can be for children if you're progressive
with some supervision.
Maybe.
Some shepherding.
I mean, I'm with Bettelheim. I think children should be exposed to how life is. I mean, then people say, isn't that what happened to you? And then, you know, that's what happened.
What happened to you?
You're exposed to life as it is, and then, you know, you grow up and make these picture books that terrify children. But no, I think they're great stories, and they're for, hopefully, for everyone. I mean, when we put the book together, I was very aware of it being kind of a combination of an art book, just a Grimm's edition you could sit down and read.
Sure.
And then something that if you were interested in Linda Nochlin or Julie Taymor or Claire Gilman, who's the curator at the Drawing Center, who also read an essay, you could just read it as a sort of art history text.
So Natalie, as we come to a close here, I'd like to make sure that folks know where to find you. So first of all, the Drawing Center.
Yes.
Your exhibition with this book and 25 of the pieces.
Yes. Through the end of June.
Through the end of June. June 28th, Drawing Center, Soho, 35 Worcester.
Yes, and it will open at the Blanton July 11th in Austin, Texas.
And run through late November or something, right?
Yes, exactly.
And then if I just wanted to find you in a gallery around New York or outside of the city, where would I find you?
So I work with Rona Hoffman in Chicago and Acme in LA.
Fantastic.
And I have a website that has a lot of information about the book and recent press, and that's just my name, Natalie-Frank.com.
Natalie-Frank.com.
Exactly.
Wonderful. Twitter following?
Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook.
The whole bit.
Yes.
Look for Natalie Frank.
Yes.
Okay. Then that sounds good. I think we've hit our marks with respect to getting folks to make sure they can find you.
Good.
And
please
I encourage anybody who has an opportunity to do so. And you're based here in New York most times?
I am. I live in the city, and my studio's in Brooklyn.
That works pretty darn well.
Yep.
I mean, if your studio wasn't in Brooklyn, you'd sort of lose some credibility.
It's in Bushwick.
Okay. That's real.
Real.
That's real. Good deal. Well, Natalie, thank you so much for being here.
Thank
it's been
you
a real
for
honor to
me.
Have you.
It's
and
been a pleasure.
Congratulations on this exciting development.
Thank you.
Yeah. So that brings to a close this edition of Counterculture. My guest this evening is Natalie Frank, an incredibly talented visual artist who recently completed this beautiful book. It's a version of Grimm's fairy tales, not the ones you probably saw on a Disney screen while you were growing up, but the real predecessors with the full unsanitized versions of the story.
Exactly.
Plus 75 incredible drawings inspired by the stories.
Exactly.
And important interviews, essays. So go out and find the book.
Bookstores accessible. Everywhere,
yeah, Amazon.
Amazon, Barnes
exactly.
and Noble.
Good deal. Mm-hmm. And come check out the show in New York and in Texas.
Thank you.
Good deal.
Thank you.
Thanks again, Natalie. Appreciate
Thank you.
It.
Thank you so much.
That brings to a close this edition of Counterculture. With that, let's cue the music.
I often think of the life I've led, and oh, it's a wonder I ain't dead. Drinking and gambling, staying out all night, living in a fool's paradise.